Hello and welcome to the Homeless Consultant channel. My name is Paul B. I am the Homeless Consultant. And today I have a, well, rather sad and yet in a way kind of fun video going down memory lane here. You know, as I've been working on this latest series of videos on junk science, one of the four main areas of junk science that I focus on, and there's plenty of others, one of them is anti-smoking. And one of the reasons I focus on anti-smoking is because I've fought against that group for 30 years because they, among other things, among so many other evil things, they have taken all of our national resources, and in fact, at this point, they've taken our international resources away from real productive cancer research, and they've moved it toward their personal goal of exterminating smokers from the face of the earth because they just hate smoking. And I've said all along through these videos that we will never be able to count the number of people who have suffered and died from all the diseases that they attribute to smoking, but particularly various forms of cancer. Now, you know, one reason I'm in this situation living in this car for the last 5 years is because I don't have any family left. And the truth is, I thought I was done mourning. I've lost my family. Minnesota took away everything I have, everything I'd worked my entire life for. All I have is what's in this car, which is falling apart around me. But on the bright side, if you could call it that, I thought that the mourning was over. And then while I was at work the other day, I just checked the news at one point, and I saw that the drummer for the rock band Rush, Neil Peart, had passed away from cancer. You know, the situation I'm in, I'm out in the open all the time. I'm either at work 8 hours a day, or the other 16 hours a day, I'm just sitting in this car surrounded by glass with all these people with osteophobia staring at me and filming me, pointing at me, calling the cops on me because I have the audacity to exist in their location as a homeless person. So it was almost a week after I got that news before I finally had a private place to really think about it, and I listened to the Rush songs, their albums, I sampled the songs all the way through their career again, and finally I just burst into tears. The reason is because I more or less grew up with Rush. I mean, I learned about them when they made their Moving Pictures album, which was maybe six albums into their career, but they ended up making about 21 studio albums. So I can't say I was with them from the very beginning. I was only about 7 years old when they started, but I've been with them through most of it. Rush has been a big part of my life, and although it's an amazing band, all three individuals in that band are absolutely extraordinary virtuosos, inspirations to me. But Neil Peart in particular, because he was the drummer, which was my first instrument that I picked up in large part because of him, and he was also the lyricist. He wrote almost all their songs, and very, very thoughtful, insightful lyrics. So I wanted to do a tribute to Neil Peart. And the idea of doing something like that for a mere mortal is kind of strange for me. But it's like he wrote himself, the song Dreamline. We are young, wandering the face of the earth, wondering what our dreams might be worth, learning that we're only immortal for a limited time. And the fact is, even though Rush stopped making music and touring many years ago, about 8 years ago, after a 40-year career, by the way, together as three good friends, the idea of any of them passing away, just, I guess you always know the idea's there, but Neil Peart, really? From cancer? What I want to do in this video is just give you my thoughts about what it was like growing up with Rush as an influence on me. And I'm not going to say that Neil Peart is Rush. That's not the case. Again, all three are extraordinary musicians and contributions to it. But the lyrics were a lot of, in many ways, the lyrics to Rush songs were the soundtrack of my life. I can associate the lyrics of various albums with what was going on at the time in my life. And he himself was paying attention to the times, which I'll talk about in a bit. So let me just go over this a bit, because I never expected that. I don't know why everybody dies, but suddenly he was gone from all the lives he left his mark upon, you know? And I'm in mourning. I thought I had lost everything. I thought Minnesota had taken it all away. These human monstrosities in this state, they just mock me and laugh at me, fear me because I'm homeless. They're waiting for me to die. They let me die. They do nothing to help. I thought there was nothing left that could hurt me. But this one really hurt. And especially when I found out that he died of cancer. Because here I am, going through all this effort at my own expense and my own time to make these videos about how we should have had effective cures for cancer a long time ago, but all of our resources have been redirected by this hate group, this anti-smoking hate group that has been around for 500 years. And I feel like I can't get my point across about that because they've done such a good job of indoctrinating a couple of generations now. And here we are again. Another one just died. Meanwhile, there's a couple others out there. Dave Mustaine from Megadeth. He has throat cancer. There's at least one other who has cancer right now. I've fought against anti-smoking for 30 years. And I fought hard for a variety of reasons, but one of them is so that we can get our national resources focused on curing cancer. Curing it. Anti-smoker leaders have come out and said we need to stop looking for a cure for cancer and focus on prevention. Prevention is a code word for them saying focus on persecuting smokers in the tobacco industry, the people who we personally hate. If you look at my other video on this topic where I talk about only anti-smoking, they are in the process of stealing up to, well, more than $230 trillion from smokers over 50 years. And the real amount's probably half of that. Neil's family asked people to give money to cancer research in honor of Neil Peart. That's such an honorable thing to do. And God bless everyone who's done that. But the problem is, the money is going to multi-millionaire executive salaries at these cancer research. I feel like the only person who's even tried to cure cancer in the last 30 years is me sometimes. And I know there's a lot of great scientists out there who want to do it, but they can't get the funding because the funding's going toward persecuting people who anti-smokers hate. This one hurts people. This one hurts a lot. I lost somebody who meant a lot to me. I never met him, but he was a driving influence throughout much of my life. So let's try to cheer this up a bit, and let's talk about Neil Peart and who he was. If you're not familiar with the band Rush, they are considered a progressive rock band, which means they're venturing into new territories of music, particularly rock music. Their first album came out, they more or less self-financed it. They had a different drummer then. Is a very good album, very like Led Zeppelin, very in your face. I would say it's better than any Led Zeppelin album in that sense. Excellent album, and they had been touring for a long time, so they could go into the studio and just record it magnificently right out of the gate. That drummer, I believe, had diabetes, and he was not able to continue. They replaced him with Neil Peart. And from then on, they just hit the ground like no other band has. With their second album, the first one with Peart, was called Fly By Night. And among other things in there is a song called Bytor and the Snow Dog, which was a hint of what was to come from these three. And over the years, they became best friends. And I'm telling you, I've always played in power trios because of Rush. I always played drums in power trios. And there's nothing like it when you've got three people who get along so well together, as I've had in my band, so blessed. The three of you, you're each accountable for your performances, because if you drop out, the whole thing falls apart. There's only three of you. And you're doing multiple things. Look at Geddy Lee and Rush. He plays bass guitar, he's singing, he plays synthesizers, and he has the bass pedals down there as well. Just outrageously skilled musicians. So Neil Peart was drums, and he would always put, you know, drums and percussion in the liner notes, sometimes drums and cymbals. I just love that. Alex Lifeson on guitar, who I personally think is the finest guitarist in rock music, most versatile. Geddy Lee, just outrageously great bass player, singer, everything he does. Just three, everything just came together with these three. So they, as I said, they perfected what you might call the rock epic, you know, a whole side, but it was back in the vinyl days, a whole side being just one song with multiple parts to it. The one that's probably most well known is 2112. And at that time, Neil Peart was reading the philosophy of Ayn Rand, objectivism, which I find to be a bunch of crap. But, you know, I don't think he really went for objectivism, but he was reading it and influenced at the time. So it made some reference in the liner notes to, you know, gratitude to Ayn Rand. And but I think he himself came out and said, well, you know, I'm not a follower of her as such. But, you know, to make an album-length rock song that is that good, that has all these different parts to it, it gets slow, it gets fast, it gets loud, it has a prelude, a beautiful ending, and for it to be that coherent and throughout, the musicmanship is outstanding. Rush, you know, obviously they're not going to be the most popular band in the general public. People who today are picking up Justin Bieber, whatever it is he does, I don't know, albums or MP3s. These are people who think about the music they're listening to. These are people who engage the music they're listening to. And throughout, Rush built a fan base that is unbelievable. Just a phenomenal fan base of, for the most part, very thoughtful people. You know, these are not Justin Bieber fans. These are thoughtful people. They think about the lyrics. They think about the band. They go to watch them. They're just you know, holding signs. They're calling for them to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. When the internet began, you know, I was in graduate school. This is before they had browsers and the web, but they had the internet earlier in the late 80s, early 90s, and they had news groups back then. And one of them was alt.fan.rush. And it was my first actual interaction online on this internet thing with people around the world. And the fans were in there, and it was just hilarious. You know, we just got along right away because we all had this love for this band, this appreciation for the band. And the band themselves were very respectful of their audience. I remember back in, I think it was 91, when Nirvana's album came out, and I was at the planetarium, I'll tell you about that in a bit, working at a planetarium, and this younger intern came in and he showed me this CD of Nirvana, and I look at the back and there's Kurt Cobain giving his audience the finger, and I just said, why would you want to listen to this? You're the reason this guy isn't a gas station attendant, because you're buying his stuff and he's flipping you off. I mean, there's no respect there. Why would you listen to this nonsense? And it's just, music's gone downhill since then. Rush does not do anything of the sort. They toured for about 40 years constantly. I don't know, maybe 200 or more days a year, touring, just, they're always there to present themselves to their fans. They're genuinely grateful to their fans. They understand that they could be working in a gas station if it wasn't for their fans. And it was this real reciprocal relationship between Rush and the fans. Now, of the three, they're all kind of reserved, though. They're not typical rock stars, you know, throwing televisions into the swimming pool and such. Nothing of the kind. They're much more reserved and private. Neil himself was the more private of the three, I would think. He did far fewer interviews, really kept himself to himself. Again, he's a very kind of introspective person. You can see the intensity. When he's playing drums, he's just, you know... he's just kind of like that. And frankly, if you look at me when I'm playing drums, I'm a lot like that. I don't know if I got it from him or what. Because, you know, sometimes I want to go, you know, do the Keith Moon stuff. I want to do that. But when I'm playing, I'm concentrating. And I don't know if I picked that up from Neil or not. But, so that's kind of what Rush is. You know, they went through the years. They finally got some radio hits, you know, around Permanent Waves with the spirit of radio. And, of course, the Moving Pictures albums where they really took off in general culture, although they still just weren't quite the type of band that was going to be, you know, top 40 general popular, even when they had hit songs like that, like Tom Sawyer and Limelight. And but they just kept building and building. But the thing was, as they did that over the years, they, unlike so many others, and don't get me wrong, I was heavily influenced by Keith Moon as a drummer for The Who, John Bonham with Led Zeppelin. I mean, these are fantastic drummers, huge influences on me. But there was something special about Rush because what they did was so special. It was unlike anything, you know, there were bands like Yes and Emerson, Lake and Palmer who kind of sort of did the same thing, but they couldn't come out with one album after another that was filled with just great songs. No filler. Very different from each other, and they weren't self-indulgent. This was the beauty of Rush. You know, Dream Theater came out later, and they were more or less looked like they were trying to become the new Rush. And they do great stuff. They're great musicians, but they're very self-indulgent. They just go off on these kind of jazz jams for a long time, and you're just like, oh, God. But then you listen to a song by Rush like La Villa Strangiato, especially the Exit Stage Left version, and they had every opportunity in the world to go off and show their stuff, but they didn't. They kept it a nice, tight instrumental package. It's about, what, probably a 10-minute song or so. I think it's the best instrumental you'll ever hear on record, especially the Exit Stage Left version. That's my opinion. One thing about Rush fans is they tend to argue about which is the best song, which is the best album. So don't argue with me, all right? This is my opinion. But people who might be my regular viewers who don't know Rush, you might want to take a look at the Exit Stage Left album. That was a live album from 1981, I believe. Again, these guys became friends, these three, as they started working together. They became very close friends. Private, not out there in the crazy world of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Although, just to make sure we understood that Rush was, in fact, a true rock band, Alex Lifeson did us the courtesy of getting arrested for starting a bar fight. So you got to give them credit, all right? They are a real band. The band was courageous. When they did their first two albums, and one thing about their early years, Geddy Lee has an extremely high voice. Some people would call it shrill. I mean, the kind of thing where if you're listening to Rush and you have a glass of fine wine, you know, fly by night, your glass could just break. All right. I personally like it. I think his voice was perfect for that band. But a lot of people didn't like that. So they weren't really taken off with their first couple albums with Neil, Fly by Night and Caress of Steel. So they pretty much went for broke. They said, well, we have a contract, one more album. What are we going to do? We're going to make the album that we want to make. And forget about the record industry and what they want. They want something that can be played on radio. Forget it, kid. We're going to do what we want to do. And they did it well. They came out with 2112. And if 2112 had not gotten airplay, that might have been the end of Rush right there. But it did get airplay. And once it did, once someone bypassed these record executives who think they know what's best for people, people with good taste in music said, wow, this is outrageously amazing. These guys are phenomenal. And that locked Rush in right there by taking that chance. That locked them in as being able to have a 40-year career together and creating some of the most extraordinary albums you will find in rock and roll, especially in progressive. They were very courageous in that way. And, you know, courage, there's a fine line between, what do they say, a fine line between courage and idiocy, I think. And I'm not going to accuse them of anything, but, oh, Rush fans might know what I'm talking about. Sometimes there's some areas of experimentation you probably should just stay away from.
Jack, relax. Get busy with the facts. No zodiacs or almanacs. No maniacs or polyester slacks. To the facts. Gonna kick some gluteus max. It's a parallax, you dig? You move around, the small gets big. It's a rig. It's action, reaction, random interaction. So who's afraid of a little abstraction? Can't get no satisfaction from the facts. You better run home, boy. And facts fact from Nome to Rome, boy. What's the deal? Spin the wheel if the dice are hot. Take a shot, play the cards. Show us what you got, what you're holding. If the cards go cold, don't go folding. Lady Luck is golden, she favors the bold, that's cold. Stop throwing stones, the night has a thousand saxophones. So get out there and rock, roll the bones. Get busy, roll the bones. Why are we here? For the free beer, roll the bones.
Yeah, that was the rap from Roll the Bones, 1991 album from Rush, or as Getty called it, a chat. probably best if they stayed out of that particular hip-hop rap genre, but you gotta give them props for having the courage to put that in the album. I like it. I think it's great. It has nothing to do with rap or hip-hop. I mean, Neil was so much more thoughtful, and he had so much more well-read and better vocabulary. He was, I mean, I have some respect for rap and hip-hop, but anyway, not to harp on that, but his skills were meant for another genre of music, let's put it that way. Also, keep in mind, these are three guys who are for 40 years. They're not just music partners or good friends. They are music partners, which is hard to do because the ego gets in the way. And they didn't allow that. But also, they were business partners. You know, this is how they feed their families, and they're making money. They're in business. They have merchandise and things like that. They're on tour. They have employees. So many support staff, you know, the roadies and everything. They made it. They made it the whole 40 years until age forced them to retire. They would have kept going forever, I think. They made it, and that is so inspirational. All right. Another great thing about Rush was that they injected a lot of clever humor into what they did. Things like their albums, back in the day when you had vinyl, if you look at the albums, the liner notes, each album would say, you know, brought to you by the letter W. I think Clockwork Angels was brought to you by the letter Y. I don't remember all of them, but it was just stuff like that was so clever. Even the way that Neil Peart, at the time, he's out there just doing stuff that drummers aren't supposed to do. He's just breaking all these boundaries with this huge drum set. And yet, when you look at the liner notes, it just says, Neil Peart, drums and percussion. It's, I mean, just total hilarious understatement. I think on Clockwork Angels it said drums and cymbals. Just brilliant. They would do things like, they'd bring strange things on stage. So they're on tour, and at one of their tours they had washing machines back there doing their laundry during the concert. When they were finally inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, finally, oh my goodness, you might want to watch that on YouTube. It was very beautiful induction. Dave Grohl from Foo Fighters did the induction, and they had some kind of made a little fun of them and such. But, you know, Neil went up there and they'd said all along, we don't care. Because the thing was, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame was dissing them all the time. So was Rolling Stone magazine. Dissed Rush all the time. Rolling Stone record guy gave him boxes. Didn't even give him one star. Gave him boxes. Just like, so bad, it's almost like just a bunch of random notes. And it's like, how could you say that about these kinds of compositions? I lost total respect for Rolling Stone as having anything to do with legitimate music way back in the 70s when I got the Rolling Stone record guide. I'd never paid attention to them again. There was this really mean-spirited guy, I think, with Rolling Stone who just, he just kept so many people away from being exposed to this great music because he had some personal distaste for Rush. I think he said Geddy Lee sounded like a cross between Robert Plant and Donald Duck. I mean, just mean-spirited, childish stuff, and so I never gave Rolling Stone the time of day after that. The record guide helped me to find Rush and their albums, but when I went out and listened to them, I was like, this magazine blows. They don't know what they're doing. They couldn't tell good music in a million years. But when they went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and they got inducted, you know, they'd been saying, well, this isn't really important to us, we don't care. But Neil kind of admitted, when he got up on stage, he said, you know, we've said all along that this really wasn't a big deal or anything, but, you know, now that I'm standing here looking at my trophy, it kind of is. So at least they were honest. I'm sure they felt dissed the whole time. They knew that they were one of the most influential rock bands in music history. They know that because of them, so many of the bands that we knew of in the 80s and the 90s and up till today existed. Because they were inspired by these three guys. And to be dissed by the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for that long was just absolutely shameful. I lost total respect for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and I still have no respect for them, to be honest, because it's like they had to bring Rush in there just to appease their huge fan base and everything. It didn't feel legit, and it was great because everyone took over the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame at this thing. I mean, they were casting shame at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame at the induction ceremony. It was beautiful. When Alex came up, the guitar player, he came up to give his speech. He pulls out a piece of paper, and every word on the speech, instead of reading a word, he just said blah. So he's like, blah 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 blah, and he just goes on the whole thing. It was like 6 minutes of him just going blah blah blah, and Neil and Getty are just back behind him going like, I don't believe he's doing this. So there's humor. Even though these guys are so serious, their lyrics are very thoughtful and introspective and insightful and learned. And yet they had this humor. That's another reason I love Rush. They did a thing like in Clockwork Angels, they did a callback to some of their songs in the earlier albums, because I think they knew that was going to be their last album, which is just fun. It's a gift to the fans to do that. They love their fans as much as their fans love them, which is quite unlike Mr. Cobain, who's there flipping off his audience, which I just find despicable. Another thing, I'll just throw this out for the Rush fans. You'll know what it is. The firm of Lyricist, Dirk, and Pratt. I'll leave that one as a special treat for the Rush fans who know what I'm talking about. Okay, so let's see. Basically, they were kind of no compromise, and yet they weren't trying to make a point. They weren't out there trying to, you know, overthrow anything. They loved what they did. They wanted to do it exceptionally well, and they couldn't do it if the music industry's telling them what to do. So they didn't compromise. And because of that, and because of their talent, their very unique talent, especially as the trio, they produced some of the best music that will probably ever be recorded in rock and roll. So that's kind of what Rush is. Again, they're incredibly influential. So many musicians you've heard of today were inspired to pick up a guitar or a bass or drumsticks, like I was, by that band, because they were that good. To me, they are the most successful rock band in history. You could argue The Who. I think in terms of just pure power rock, The Who's probably the best, but their catalog isn't... It's great, but it isn't like Rush. Rush, their albums are masterpieces, and there's a couple masterpieces from The Who, but not all of them. and The Who did have some filler. And The Who's a great band, and so is Led Zeppelin, of course. But Rush really did everything right. They got together, they were friends, they were business partners, they did extraordinary work, they interacted, you know, they cared about their fans enough to, you know, tour as much as they did. They did it their way, they did it right, they didn't go off into, you know, the heroin and all that stuff, or at least that we know of. They didn't go off and set bad examples like that. They even set a good example for me in this regard, my work ethic. I talk about my work ethic in my homeless consultant videos. How people I work with just don't show up to work. I haven't had a day off. I haven't taken a day off work, say, for being sick in my adult life. I've had to take days off because this car's falling apart. But I haven't. But I wouldn't do that. My work ethic is very strong, and part of it is from observing. Not all of it. Part of it is from observing Rush over the years. They had a strong work ethic. In fact, I was really impressed when I was young. I must have been about 13 when I saw Exit Stage Left live, or some part of it on TV back then. And just because Alex was wearing a sport coat, he was wearing a red sport coat with his white Stratocaster, and I was just impressed that this rock and roll musician was wearing a sport coat. Now, I don't expect anyone to go out there wearing a three-piece suit or anything, but it showed some respect, and it showed some dignity. It showed self-respect. You know, these guys go out there with all the tattoos, and they've got all the junk and the rings and stuff. They're not even showing that they love themselves. How are they going to love their fans? It just really impressed me. And in fact, when I moved to Minnesota, I would always wear a sport coat to work. And that lasted about a year because the people around me thought I was such a weirdo for wanting to actually dress nicely at my professional job. Like I said, there's a reason why I'm living in this car. It's called Minnesota. Neil Peart was sometimes called the Professor. His fans would call him the Professor, and I'm not going to argue with it. I think there was even a rumor out there one time that he had a PhD or something, and if you know what I think about PhDs, I'm happy to say that he did not. He just loved to learn. He loved to read. He loved to engage the world he lived in. Now, we do part paths right about there, because he did things like looking into Ayn Rand, which, you know, didn't take me long to figure out that was something I wanted nothing to do with. A lot of these songs that Rush did actually, and this ties it into the junk science videos, a lot of the songs that Rush did were tied to science, and they were very influential and inspirational to me because I loved science, legitimate science, so much growing up. And again, I didn't realize what junk science was until I was much older, until I was in college. So their songs, let me see if I can find it here. So for example, the song Natural Science, which may be it's certainly one of their very best songs, and they themselves, I think, have said that it's their favorite to play. Just an outrageously good song from start to finish. But it's referring to the Big Bang. You know, the universe began to expand, and as my videos here show you, the Big Bang is a bunch of crap. That's based on actual evidence. So even someone like this, Neil Peart, was not immune to being sucked into what he hears on television or what he reads. You know, so that's why I wouldn't look at him as a professor. I don't look at him as an intellectual hero, except to the extent that he did try to investigate the world he lived in. He wasn't sitting and staring at a cell phone. He wasn't letting his brain just empty, just all the fluid just drain out over the course of his life and doing nothing. He was trying to do something to learn about the world and engage the world he lived in, and he wrote about it, and he wrote about it beautifully. The amazing thing is he can write about something that's nonsense like Big Bang Revolution, but he writes about it beautifully. It's almost kind of scary because in a way that helps other people believe this stuff. But that's how good of a writer he was. He was a very good writer, a lyricist.
Thank you.
Like High Water, the song High Water that closes out Hold Your Fire album, you know, when some, you know, when this, what, I can't remember the lyrics now, when it broke through the surface of the water just to see the starry dome, you know, kind of like evolving into, from a single cell creature or something. So again, I'm not one who just sits there and calls Neil Peart a god. I would never call any man a god, period, end of story. If you know me at all, I believe I know exactly who God is. He created all of this. And I'll be honest with you folks, this is really why I started crying. Because for all the wonderful things Neil did, and I don't know what happened in his latter years. He was very private. You didn't hear anything from him or about him. I don't see any evidence that he, you know, was saved. And it's not good enough to just say, well, I don't believe in God. I don't believe in Jesus, so this is irrelevant. What you believe about it has nothing to do with where Neil is right now and what he's experiencing right now. And folks, I'm really, really sad and frightened for where he might be right now. But I'm going to try to focus this on what he did in this world. But I had to mention that. I had to say that because there's two other members of that band who are still alive. And I know Getty in particular. They did a song called Red Sector A, which is more or less about the Holocaust. Concentration camps. And Getty has gone on record saying, I can't believe in a God who would allow the Holocaust to happen. And yeah, I understand where you would come up with that if you have not researched things like the Bible. Not just read it casually or listen to what people who hate the Bible say about it, but study the Bible. When you study it and you see how consistent it is from start to finish, you realize that something like the Holocaust was referred to in the Bible and the purpose of it was there. If there wasn't a Holocaust, Israel would not exist right now. Israel existing is one of the precursors for the end times when God's going to clean this place up. It had to happen. See, the gospel is about man needing a savior. Given the law, the Ten Commandments, but you keep breaking the Ten Commandments, even if you don't want to. You can't live up to the standards of God, and He is so holy and above us that He can't. You can't be in His presence unless something intervenes, and that's what Jesus did. He died to take our punishment for that. And as God wraps this world up and brings in the eternal kingdom, things had to happen. Now, they're introduced by humans who are obviously quite flawed and evil. That's where the Holocaust came from. God took the Holocaust and turned it into something beautiful. The only time that a race of people who had been dispersed across the entire planet for 2,000 years, and yet they maintained their racial identity, and they're coming back together in their original land. That's miraculous. That doesn't happen in this world. But it happens when God's controlling things. So not to harp on the religion here, but you know, when Getty, I feel really sad for Getty when he says that the Holocaust prevents him from believing in God. The Holocaust came from Hitler and the people who blindly followed him. God took the Holocaust and turned it into something beautiful. Israel, a beautiful, beautiful country. And Israel is going to be the center of affairs going forward. Right into the kingdom when Jesus returns. You see, Alex and Getty still have an opportunity to hear this gospel. I guess that's why I'm saying it, like they're ever going to watch this video. I don't know what Neil went through in his latter years. I hope he heard that gospel and that he believed in it. Let's leave that alone for now and go on to my tribute to a mere man. Neil had some hard times. Everything was going really well up until I think it was around 1993. He had a common law wife and a daughter, his daughter was killed in a car accident. And less than a year later, his common-law wife also died from cancer. Again, you can see why I'm so infuriated by this anti-smoking industry, which has destroyed our ability to destroy cancer. That devastated him and changed his life. He did remarry, and he had another daughter. But that was a very difficult time for anyone. People wondered if the band would go on or anything, but, you know, he came back. They didn't make albums as often, but it's something very difficult he had to deal with. And to the credit of his fans, they respected his privacy and his need to, you know, deal with this effectively. You know, his fans don't show up at the door, as far as I'm aware. I mean, Rush fans are not like that. Like I said, they're much more thoughtful and intellectual. They're much more respectful of the band. You look at the tributes Neil is receiving, you know, on Twitter and things. These memes set up for that, just absolutely beautiful. You know, now they're wrong about the science, though. I remember one of them said, you know, the Earth is 4 billion years old, and yet you were lucky enough to live when Rush was playing. Okay, now if you said the Earth is 6,000 years old and we're lucky enough to live when Rush is playing, okay, I get where you're going. You see, I mean, that's the problem, though. But if you ignore the junk science, and the junk science has just influenced so many people, what can you do about it? I'm trying with these videos. Let's ignore that for a minute. That was a beautiful tribute, though. The point is, people have been around for a long, long, long time. We are, in fact, very privileged to have lived at a time when such a great band was playing. Now, I never got to see them play live in all these years. For one thing, just what I was doing with school and everything, I never had an opportunity, and I didn't have friends who were Rush fans, so I'd be going alone if I did. The one time was when Rush, I can't remember exactly when, 2008, 2009, something like that, they were going to play the Minnesota State Fair, which was very close to where I lived, and they were going to play the Moving Pictures album all the way through for the first time ever. Okay? So that one I got tickets for right away. You know, best tickets you can get. And then the Minnesota, you know, this is after the smoking ban in Minnesota, then the Minnesota State Fair officials, who were influenced by this hate group, they banned smoking at the fair, except that they created like this corral where they put the smokers. You can go there and smoke. You know, over here's the corral with the cattle. Over here's the one with the pigs. Over here's the one with the smokers. I mean, you can't even make this stuff up, how blatant it was what they're doing to smokers, just trying to humiliate, shame them, treat them like less than second-class citizens, literally treating them like the animals at the fair. And I can't do that. I know that anti-smoking is the reason we don't have effective cancer research in this world. I've studied that for 30 years. So I had to let the tickets go, and I had to boycott the state fair from then on, forever, going forward. I had to boycott it. But you know what? I didn't get to see Rush, but why did I do that? I did it in part because of the influence of people like Neil Peart. When I read his lyrics, I'll give you an example. I really relate to a song called Mission from Hold Your Fire, which was, I think, 1987. Spirits fly on dangerous missions, imaginations on fire, focused high on soaring ambitions, consumed in a single desire. In the grip of a nameless possession, slave to a driving obsession, a spirit with a vision is a dream with a mission. And I have felt a mission to fight against this anti-smoking evil and to get our national and international resources finally focused, like Kennedy focused our resources on going to the moon in less than a decade, which we did. Those resources should be focused on ending cancer in less than a decade, which we could do if it wasn't all about hating smokers. This song, Mission, it goes on to talk about something else. A lot of people don't understand me, because I was so heavily influenced by someone like Neil Peart, who talks about standing up for what you believe in. Okay, boycotting the state fair, even if it means I never get to see Rush ever in my entire life. Because it was more important to take that moral stand against those sick degenerates who run the state fair, who thought it was funny to put a certain group of people, human beings, their equals, into a pen right next to the animals. I didn't think it was funny. Because if you listen to Red Sector A again, that song about the Holocaust, there's another example of where people who were considered subhuman were put into pens. It's never a good thing, folks. It's never a good thing. I had to stand up against that. And I will despise this leadership in Minnesota for the rest of my life, if only, forget about being homeless, losing everything I worked my life for, if only because of them, I did not get to see Rush live ever in my entire life. Ever. Even though I followed them almost from the beginning of their career. His song, though, goes on to explain how someone like me can devote myself to fighting against these evils. Not just anti-smoking, but all these other ones. Junk science, just corporate corruption, government corruption, all the things I fight against. Why do I do that? Why do I do that when it creates a risk of possibly me ending up having to live in a car? Why would I do that? Well, the song goes on to say, it's cold comfort to the ones without it. To know how they struggled, how they suffered about it. If their lives were exotic and strange, they would likely have gladly exchanged them for maybe something a little more plain. Maybe something a little more sane. We each pay a fabulous price for our visions of paradise. But a spirit with a vision is a dream with a mission. What he's basically saying is he's acknowledging that there's these people who did things, the Wright brothers, they had to fly, they had to fly. They had to figure out how it's done. And what about all the others who tried and they died in the process? Ordinary people out there who just sit in front of the idiot box all day or staring at their phones, the modern idiot box, these people, they can't even comprehend why someone would focus all their time trying to fly back in 1900. They can't figure out why I would sit here and fight against anti-smoking, which they think is a benefactor of society. And it's probably the most evil thing we have going in the world today. Why would I fight against junk science? Junk science is our modern world. That's what he's saying. Most people probably, it's cold comfort to the ones without this drive that people like me have. I relate to that song completely. But even Neil got it wrong. He said they would likely have gladly exchanged it for something a little more plain. Okay, well maybe he didn't get it wrong. I guess if I could flip a switch and get rid of this and just... But the thing is, to do that, I would have to live like a dumbed down moron who's staring at an idiot box all day. And I don't want that. I don't want that for my life. So I have to boycott the Minnesota State Fair and miss seeing Rush play live. And I can only hope that through his lyrics, Neil influenced a lot of other people to take those kinds of moral stands, because he talked about it a lot in his lyrics. And I'm very grateful. I will always be grateful to Neil Peart for that. Bravado, the song Bravado. Now, he took this particular line from a book he read. That's what inspired him to write the song. But the line is, we will pay the price, but we will not count the cost. In other words, doing the right thing is so important that I will pay the price to do the right thing. And we will not count the cost. Now, granted, you hear me counting the cost often in here. But the simple fact is, I did the right thing. I did everything right. I did everything right. And when I had my home taken away from me illegally, other people did the wrong thing. And it's precisely because I stood up for what is right that I can look in a mirror. I can have dignity. I can look in a mirror and like what I see, even though I hate the circumstances I'm in. But all these people who did nothing to help me, who let me come out here and live this way, who were just letting me die and laughing the whole time, maybe they can look in a mirror, but if they can like what they see, then those people are just demonic. They should be the ones carrying around the shame and the guilt. Not people who just happen to choose a particular behavior that somebody doesn't like. Well, let's see, what else do we have here? As far as impact on me, obviously drumming. You know, Neil, I remember early on I would listen to Neil, and he had this, it sounded like his cymbal was going. It sounded like that. I can't do it. I'm not warmed up, and it's like 13 degrees out. My hands are just frozen, so I can't really play anything. But he would play, so, and that sounds simple, but in the context of the songs, it was really influential because it before I learned rudiments, this taught me that you can kind of do audio tricks. Because by throwing in the snare where you would throw in the right hand, it makes you think, you fill in the blanks in your mind, and you think he's going. So you think he's playing at the super high speed with his right hand, but he's not. He's doing the trade-off here. You know, and he'd do stuff like that. He was a master of his instrument. Now, he was a little bit limited and restricted. I saw him play with Buddy Rich's band, and he couldn't really do it. He couldn't do the jazz stuff that well. He did a fine job. I mean, he didn't fall apart like I would. He did a very good job with it, but he wasn't doing the jazz licks like Buddy Rich could. And then when he went off into the solo, he carried it into his solo, his rock and roll solo. But again, courage. That takes a lot of courage. He's not a jazz player, but he went and played with one of the foremost jazz bands, you know, big bands of our era, and he tried to fill Buddy Rich's shoes for a moment. That takes a lot of courage, and he did a great job. At the style that he played, he was fantastic. He was a great, magnificent drummer. A lot of people would say he's the best drummer ever. I don't think you can say that about anybody because you have these different styles and different techniques. My point is that he was perfect for Rush. He was perfect for Rush. And he was a virtuoso at his own style and his instrument. And for that, I give him all the props in the world. I'm not going to say he's the best drummer ever. I don't think anyone is. Keith Moon was fantastic at what he did, and it's a legitimate complaint to say he was a bad drummer in some ways. You know, John Bonham, everyone has their style. He was perfect for Rush. In that sense, if you didn't have Neil Peart, you would still have a very good band because the other two guys were so great. Their first album, when they had John Rutsey playing drums, John Rutsey did a great job. He played very well for that style of music. It was just more straight up rock and roll, you know, you know, that kind of thing. But Neil brought in all these, so many drums and cymbals and percussion and gongs and just the, you know, those kinds of licks that you just didn't really hear in drums. Again, listen to La Villa Stragiato, and he could break down into some really cool jazzy stuff from time to time. He could do it. The breakdown in Free Will. Amazing. La Villa Stragiato. So he was versatile, but he wasn't going to play heavy metal. He could play double bass, but he wasn't going to go out there and play Slayer songs. He wouldn't have that skill. But it's okay. He didn't need it. That's not what Rush was doing. Let's see. What else have I left out? Oh, yes. I told you about the planetarium earlier, back in 1991. So I was just finishing up undergraduate, and I was an intern at the planetarium. Okay? And I wanted to do a laser light show to the music of Rush. but we didn't have a laser light system. So what happened was the museum director and the tech assistant and the educator, in other words, the full-time staff, they went on a paid vacation to the South Pacific on a cruise ship to watch an eclipse because it's work-related, you see, so someone else pays for it. I didn't get to go on the cruise ship. I had to sit there and run the planetarium while they're gone. So what I did was I went to the board meeting, which was scheduled in that time for the whole museum, and I sat in as their representative, and I talked them into buying a laser light system. So when the director got back from his vacation, you know, he had like a $30,000 bill for this laser light gear. Oh, those were fun times. So I spent the next 1 year of my life, 1 year, making a laser light show to the music of Rush. And it was fun. I had to do it when I wasn't at school. Quite often I would do it in the middle of the night. I would go in there at, say, midnight. The whole museum's closed. I would go into the planetarium, kick on the lasers and the stars, the Godot projector, this Rush music playing on this great sound system, and I'd bring my guitar and my amp and just sit in there and play these Rush songs, you know, Limelight. I'd be playing guitar along with it and all that. In fact, one time I forgot to turn off the alarm to the museum, so I'm in there playing this Rush music with my guitar, and the police come in checking out what's going on. That must have been quite a sight for them to see, but it was just tons of fun. I wanted to call it the Spirit of Rush. That's what I wanted to call the show. But the director, I guess he's getting back at me for getting the laser system or something. He was a great guy, not dissing him. He ended up calling it something more simple to appeal to the masses. It's like, all right, well, I wanted it to appeal to Rush fans because I didn't think the general population was really going to come in for that show. One interesting thing, though, I learned something when I was doing the laser light show. Back then, they had real radio, kind of the Wolfman Jack kind of thing. You know, the 50s, 60s, 70s, real, true radio. Not these shock jocks, whatever they call them, these people. You just, oh, they just make my stomach turn listening to them talk on the radio. So I already kind of knew some of the DJs because I would call in and I had such an interest in audio production and things. I recorded the soundtrack for it at a radio station. We did it in between songs. So I'm there while he's doing his DJ, you know, for the night. And when the song's playing, we'd go back to working on the soundtrack. And there was this... I had a CD player. CD players had come out about 4 years earlier, at least as far as me being able to get one. They were like $500, you know. But he had a professional CD player for the radio station, and it went frame by frame, which, of course, mine never would. And I really interesting, because I remember how I was legitimately shocked. This was a lesson I learned. When we put Tom Sawyer on there, we would go through the frames, and guess what? At the beginning, because Tom Sawyer starts out with boom, you know, boom. Modern day warrior, mean style, you know, starts out with that big chord, and then the drums taking it, driving it on. Neil hit the bass drum a couple of frames before the rest of the band came in. Now, that may not sound like much today, okay? I get it. But you gotta understand, this is how perfect I thought he was as a drummer. I actually was shocked. I was just like, Neil was early. Now, this is like a microsecond. I mean, you can't tell. It's not even a flam. You know, a flam's where you're like that. You can kind of hear the grace note before it. This is just a millisecond before. You're not going to notice. But I was genuinely shocked that he didn't start at the same time as everyone else. Just, I don't know if other people find that as funny as I did, but that was when I realized that Neil Peart wasn't perfect as a drummer. Oh, just good times, good times, good times. Another thing I did was I started working on a Rush tribute song, which was to just kind of a quick instrumental, or not quick, but an instrumental to bring a lot of these themes and the style of their music into something that just kind of a tribute to them. It's something I was working on when I lost my home, of all my many, many projects I had going on. So I never got to finish it. If I can dig it out, maybe I'll put it at the end of this. I don't think it was finished enough where I'm going to feel really comfortable with it. But, you know, I mean, I felt compelled to create this kind of tribute because their style really is unique. And along those lines, let me just go through their albums here real quick. So their first album was Rush with John Rutsey on drums. Again, very Led Zeppelin-esque, just hard rock. Excellent, fantastic album. One of my very favorites of theirs. Then they came out with Fly By Night and Caress of Steel. Those are the first ones with Neil Peart. That's where they're getting experimental. The production has its own unique kind of quality to it versus the ones that flank it. Let's see. So Fly By Night, yeah, By Tour and the Snow Dog. So they're starting to toy with epic songs. Even in the end, at the end, it's a shorter song, but it has that epic feel to it. They were immediately branching off into something very experimental and progressive. And I don't mean progressive like the fake political ideology today, which is just straight up communist, socialist. I'm talking about people who really do progress instead of going backwards to the Soviet Union, moving forward, for example. That's what they were doing. They were progressing music forward. The next album, Bastille Day, you know, I Think I'm Going Bald. I did my own version of I Think I'm Going Bald on this channel somewhere a little while back. The Necromancer, that was another one where they had a long epic type song. But Fly By Night and Caress of Steel had their own vibe to them. 2112 kind of sort of shared that in terms of the production, how the production was made. But 2112 was just this, it had the whole side length song, 2112. And then it had the other songs on the side B. From there, they went to A Farewell to Kings. So I would say 2112 and A Farewell to Kings, to me, maybe even Hemispheres, have their own feel to them, their own unique vibe. They sound similar, like they were the same band. Then they went to Permanent Waves. Permanent Waves was another era of Rush. Moving Pictures, for example, with Tom Sawyer on it. Permanent Waves and Moving Pictures were kind of that vibe. Just the feeling of them is a little bit different. The different production value, the songs are a lot more styled like radio type songs, you know, 3 minute, 5 minute songs, although, well, let's face it, the camera, Free Will, okay, I get your point, but then they came out with, then they started doing some experimentation. They backed the guitars off a bit, and they started bringing in the synthesizers more heavy with Signals, and the song Subdivisions was very popular, especially with nerds and geeks in high schools. Probably myself among them. It appealed to them. Then their next album, Grace Under Pressure, also had that same kind of feel as Signals. Then, this is when I started college. Right when I started college, Power Windows came out. Power Windows had a whole different vibe to it. It had a darkness to it. The production was different. And it was about, you know, things like, it was about Cold War issues. And we were right in the height of the Cold War. And at that time, you did have to worry about nuclear war breaking out, legitimately. War with the Soviet Union. So, again, Peart's lyrics were the soundtrack of my life. When you listen to the songs on Power Windows, I'm taken immediately back to my freshman year of college. And the songs in there were so much attuned to what was going on in the world. The next album, Hold Your Fire, was very similar, and yet it was almost a hybrid, like a bridge. Hold Your Fire had a... In fact, I didn't like Hold Your Fire the first time I heard it, and the only reason, and this is my bad, not theirs, at the very beginning of the song, you know, Force 10, the opener of the album, Neil does this thing where he's like, tough times, man, tough talk. Or not before the singing, but as they're doing the music, do, 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 do. And I don't know why, but for some reason I thought he had dumbed down his playing. I just thought, well, that's ridiculous. A bunch of eighth notes, really? I said, this is Neil Peart. What's he doing a bunch of eighth notes for? He's getting lazy. And I just didn't give it time. Of course, after I started listening to the whole album, it's a fantastic album. And it has a song on there that the band themselves regret. I don't know why. Alex and Getty have said frequently, I think, that Tai Shan, the song about China, that they're so ashamed that they ever did it. They're just embarrassed. It's a beautiful song, though. See, Neil went, I think, bicycle riding through China, I believe. I don't think he was riding the motorcycles then. I'm not sure. But he wrote books. He wrote a book about that trip. And the song is beautiful. It's so thoughtful. You know, he's just talking about sitting in this land, this ancient land, and what has happened in this place, something that Americans can't relate to. And, of course, he's talking about before communist China, which is just pure evil. You know, let's kill as many of our own people as we can, like so much else we have today. But that's the thing. He could be in this horrible communist country that just shoots people in the head for whatever reason, or puts them in a labor camp, or a re-education camp, I'm sorry, because it's the government's job to teach them what's true and what's not true. You see, that's communism. He could be in a land like that that's so oppressive, and instead he's able to feel what led up to that, all those centuries of this ancient culture. Beautiful, beautiful song. And then they came out with the song, or the album, Presto. And I have to say, I have never liked Presto. To me, it's like it's a completely different band. I can't find one song on there that I like. It's unlistenable to me, and I don't know why. I really don't. The fact is, there's a couple others down there, Snakes and Arrows and Vapor Trails. Those three albums, I'd get no pleasure out of listening to them whatsoever. And yet, every other Rush album, from start to finish, without exception throughout, not a piece of filler in it, these are the best albums ever made. I don't understand that. And it's interesting how people have such different tastes. But then they came out, after Presto, they came out with Roll the Bones, which had a Presto-type feel from the engineering standpoint, but they were kind of getting back to the basics. They were getting back to they're bringing the guitars back, and then Counterparts and Test for Echo. So I put Roll the Bones, Counterparts, and Test for Echo in their own kind of genre, their own subgenre. There's a vibe to those three albums, and this is before Neil's tragedy with his family, and that's what changed things going forward from there. Some of the most significant things that happened in my life and that ever will happen in my life happened at the time of Roll the Bones and Counterparts. You know, things like realizing that this goal of getting a PhD was a waste of time, that academia was a cult, that so much of what I'd learned as a child was wrong. It was a lie. Big Bang, evolution, all this stuff was just a complete lie. I was finally beginning to realize that, and I also had a lot of personal things going on. Again, it's the soundtrack to my life. Beautiful songs in there. After that, they kind of took a break because of Neil's tragedy. They came out with the Vapor Trails and Snakes and Arrows, which, again, I just don't like. I'm sorry. I don't know why. I can't listen to them. And then at the end of their career, around 2012, they came out with Clockwork Angels, which they just came back guns a-blazing, just both barrels loaded. They just knocked it out of the park. They went back almost to the 2112 era, only with modern production. Another concept album, although I think they won't admit it, but it's obviously a concept album. And the interesting thing is, at the end of that album, the last song that they will have recorded, I kind of could tell when I heard it the first time, it sounds like they're wrapping it up. It sounds like they're not going to be playing anymore, just from what that song was discussing. And with that in mind, let me go over the first and the last lyrics of Rush with Neil Peart. The first lyric is from the opener on the Fly By Night album, Fly By Night. Know your place in life is where you want to be. Don't let them tell you that you owe it all to me. Keep on looking forward, no use in looking around. Hold your head above the crowd, and they won't bring you down. Okay? So, again, you can tell right away, a little bit thoughtful. I mean, not a whole lot in there. You have to go through the rest of the song. But that's how I started out with Neil Peart. Let's hear how they ended, roughly 40 years later, with A Clockwork Angels. The last song in there is called The Garden. And the last lyrics in there are, "The measure of a life is a measure of love and respect. So hard to earn, so easily burned. In the fullness of time, a garden to nurture and protect. The treasure of a life is a measure of love and respect. The way you live, the gifts that you give. In the fullness of time, it's the only return that you expect." And then he goes, and then he goes into the very last lyric that Rush will ever sing. And given what happened afterwards, I can say it. "The future disappears into memory, with only a moment between. Forever dwells in that moment. Hope is what remains to be seen in the fullness of time, a garden to nurture and protect." And so any hope of a future with Rush, a band of distinguished gentlemen who I grew up with, that future now disappears into my memory. The only thing we have in our lives, folks, is right now. Those of us who grew up with Rush and they impacted other people's lives like they did mine, losing any of these three guys is losing a part of your family. Losing a significant other person. And of course we knew it had to happen someday. But like I said, folks, I've lost everything. I've lost my family. I have no family left. My parents died a few years before Minnesota took everything else I had, everything I'd worked my life for. I sit here and I make all these videos that nobody watches or cares about. Nobody helps me. They just sit there and watch me suffer and die while they're eating a box of popcorn. I gotta tell you, I thought I had nothing left to lose. this is a big loss. I hope Neil Peart was saved. I really do. I want him in heaven. I want that man in heaven. But regardless of what happened there, what he did in this life was, in fact, to give us so many gifts. This one person affected so many other people. And only in a positive way. And that, folks, is inspirational. I can only hope that you and I will do the same. Neil, I love you, man. Thank you so much. And thanks all of you for watching.